So my name is Nishant. I'm going to study for a master's in electrical engineering at the University of Twente. And currently I'm a research intern at IIT Delhi, which is Indian Institute of Technology. And so now to the questions that I have, like what to do after coming to the Netherlands. Okay, now about the second year. So there's like a 20 ECTS internship that I have to do. So is it better to do it in a company or is it better to do it in another university lab if I can find it?
Yeah,
If I
if
want
you can,
to do a
if
PhD.
you want to do a PhD, and if you, I mean, at the end of the year, you will already have an idea. Like, so what is your structure? Is it like 60 CTS coursework,
60
20
coursework,
intensive,
20
and
ECTS.
40 thesis, right? That's very nice. So, I mean, normally here, what people have who are doing PhDs, they have like 60, 15, and 45. So it is just a little bit different. It's fine. If you want to do a PhD, you should look for universities. But getting this short internship in universities sometimes may be a problem. Like, you might not find, I mean, not problem. Like, if you find it, it's fine. But then you should start looking for it. That's why, like, if you know what you are going to do the thesis, then you can somehow try to relate it. Like, the internship can be treated as like the foundation, and then you have the extension in your thesis. That will help you a lot. Otherwise, you do two times hard work and no use. I mean, that's what people try to do here. Those things you learn after you do it yourself, because those are difficult to explain. But if you can build upon that thing, what you're doing in the intensive, and structure it in that way by talking with a supervisor whom you find and discuss, then it will be really useful, like for you. And for PhD, it's really good to go to another university. You can look for also universities in Belgium. It is also possible, because in
Yeah,
Schengen,
Leuven
I mean, it's up to you. I'm just saying, like, Leuven is one of them. There are many others. So you can look for other universities. Only thing is, normally the supervisor, the team which you join, they also have some contacts in different universities, because they are working with papers and other things. So they also suggest you something. Sometimes
okay.
you suggest something, and this goes on like a discussion. And most of the time, they never say you no directly. They will have a discussion. They discuss the pros and cons, and then they reach to a conclusion. Like, they also want to hear what you say, most of the time.
So it's better to discuss with a like a potential mentor that if I want to work on this project of yours, then I
Yeah,
can
I
do.
mean, in that sense, I would say at the end of the first year, you should have already developed something like a 5% idea of what you're going to do the thesis, and then you can link it to this, because obviously you also need to search for the internship, right? If you start searching at the end of first year, then it will be too late, I think, at least for the internship, not for the thesis. You need some time also to apply and a position. Normally these positions are not difficult, but I mean, you can. I don't know about electrical, but RWTH Aachen, it's very good for computer science. Most people go there. I think in electronics also it is good, because one of my friend was there. I don't remember. He was doing internship or something. So you can go there. Like, there are Germany, Belgium, these are very close to Netherlands. So those places most people go. I don't think going to Switzerland and Sweden is easy, but going to Germany and Belgium is easy. But it depends. Like, it may be also in Netherlands. So depends completely on your team and what is your interest, and is it available in those universities or not, and there are many other things. But there is also another thing, you should explore it in 20. I don't know, I said it in the master's video, that every university has a exchange program. Like, the it's not exactly a thesis exchange, it's like a short exchange program, which is generally substituted for the internships. But that depends. So one thing you always remember, that all these things are written something on paper, but you can bend all these things, which most people don't know, because 100% of the things here in Netherlands are flexible, and the professor has very much power in all those things. He's like the autonomous, he has very much autonomous power. So if he feels that this is okay, and certain things can be even bent, like, sometimes it is not written anywhere, but your 20 cities can be substituted for certain visit to certain school for also doing the same thing. So those things, even if it is not in the rules, you can talk with them and then maybe they agree and they change the rules or something, because these are just schemes and they always are free to change it the way they like it to fit it into that.
Okay. So I wanted to ask how to like pick a mentor. Do you pick like a very senior person and then they don't have time or what? Or
No. I mean, I never looked like that. First was during my master's kickoff, we had 8 or 9 research groups in computer science who do research on different themes. And they give a short pitch presentation, like a pitch for like 2 minutes or something or 3 minutes, where they discuss what are the projects going on and what is their future plan. So that was really helpful. That was right in the day one or day two when the university opened and during the master's kickoff in first week of September. So in that, I already had a brief idea of the out of the 8. I decided by just seeing the pitch, I was so impressed because everyone's pitch was very good to understand what is happening. And I chose like 2 or 3, I don't remember, out of these 8 pitches. And that master's kickoff was for 2-3 days. So the next days when they were present, any member from their group was present, maybe a PhD or a professor, any member from that group. I just talk with that selected groups, like 2 or 3 groups that I selected. I just talked with them to know like, okay, really what I'm understanding is okay, or it was like something else and I understood something else because they just want to sell their idea or something. Because most people, the thing is to sell their idea so that they have these master students or people start working on it and it spreads to a larger number of people. And that helped a lot because when you know this beforehand, right from the beginning,
yeah, I know, and the group, because in 20 you have to like select the group first.
Okay.
The application is going on.
Okay. Because in our case, it was not the case. Like maybe they might have changed now, but at that time you had still option till the end of first year to decide which group you want to go talk. But that also caused a lot of problems for many people because many people could not make that decision and it helped, it made delayed their thesis. And there are some people who took 2.5 years, 3 years. So no one wants to do that. So that's why like it's better to, these are the things, like if you make these decisions and you're proactive, these are the two things. If you lose track of these two things, then no one can stop you from extending a thesis. Like, because unless you talk, they won't come to you and say, okay, you are getting delayed, do it. It's not going to happen. So that's what most people don't think about it. Like maybe because of pressure, I don't know, but it's up to you to like take the anchor of your thesis or whatever you're doing.
Yeah.
And so you don't need to see like the, once I have that group, then you can, I mean, you cannot say by going there that like normally, because normally who are full professors, they normally don't have time to, they act as a super mentor, you can say, like mentor above mentor. So suppose you are part of a research group and someone, assistant or associate professor who's young, who takes you as his, I mean, he's your daily supervisor. So your professor, that person who is the head of the research group or something, he will guide you sometimes when you need his help, but not like he will guide you every day or every once a week or something like that. So normally they don't take directly because even PhD students don't get that much time from them. So in that sense, and if you see the quality, then it's really good. You cannot compare it to India or other places, like that this person is young in that group, like suppose assistant or associate professor, maybe he might be not experienced. It's not the case. Like there might be some problems with him, but once you talk with him, you'll know. So they are also really talented, like they're published somewhere or maybe they're working in the industry or depends on their profile. And you can always look at the profile before selecting, like in the Google Scholar or many other places. And you can talk also with the previous students, like they will have it in the website or somewhere, like what was their experience? Because it's not about the content, it's also about how you deal with the supervisor, like the way of talking and how he guides you. These are very important when you, although it is 9 months or very short, but still.
So do you suggest, like, if I want more focus on me, so I should pick a younger professor or what? Because
Yeah,
I'm interested in,
I don't think
like,
I don't think you'll find a, I mean, if you select, I don't think you'll be able to select a person who is a full professor to be your daily supervisor. Normally, it's not the case. That's what I'm saying. Like, but why I'm not saying anything about younger is because maybe an assistant or associate professor may be also older. Like, I mean, it depends. Like, so that's why it's better to see the profile, like not the citation count, but by profile, I mean, what areas has he published and what is his field and how does it match to your interest?
Okay.
And suppose, because when you talk with this, suppose you shortlist, like, what, I mean, now you have a group,
yeah.
Suppose you shortlist two persons as a supervisor and you talk with them, then also you can know by talking, like, if you're really good, then you can know, like, okay, this person may be fitting for me, and then go ahead with that person with further talks or something like that. So I don't think there's any criteria like young or old.
That's what I mean, like senior, like a full
yeah,
professor might not have that much time. And
No. Normally, I think according to rule also, they are not, I mean, for PhDs, sometimes they give time. I mean, now what I'm feeling is like, I have a daily supervisor, but I have now two professors. Normally, you don't have two professors during a PhD. You have one promoter. Professor is called promoter. But I have two promoters now, which is very rare in most PhDs, because one of the professor, he was associate professor when I was hired. So he was supposed to be my daily supervisor. But
okay.
Then he became a full professor after I was hired. So that's why I have two. But the thing is, like, half of the time, I think I have told this 100 times. I don't know if you've seen them in the
yes.
videos. So one is like half of the time in Delft, one is half of the time in Frankfurt, and half of the time they're here. So the good thing in that is that although they're half of the time, we have once a week meeting,
mm-hmm.
and which is also not, it doesn't happen in every PhD that you have meeting once. Even during master's, I didn't have once a week meeting. And you can do experiments or you can do certain works with the help of master thesis students in Delft or maybe in Frankfurt. You have a lot of connections, like you can leverage them for your benefits.
Okay. So that's about it. That's all my questions. Thank you for your time.
Okay.